So I thought I would start with a poem because I'm thrilled, excited to be here, and also kind of afraid. So, and I have lots of fears. So I thought I would start with this poem by way of prologue. I have so many fears of the night, of growing old, of seeing those I have loved fall ill or die, of my own death. Those are normal fears, of course, but I also have stranger fears of my heart pounding too quickly, of unexpectedly going blind and not finding my way home, of losing my memory before I find the time to write the story still dormant in me, of cold winters which will never end. I'm also afraid to get wet in the rain, to stand on my head, terrible at yoga, to run down staircases, and police, soldiers, and immigration officers terrify me. Yes, I am full of fears. If you took them away, I would be weightless and free. You would see me dance like a dry brown leaf, and then I'd blow away in the autumn wind. I chose to start with this poem because I've just gotten back from Spain. I just spent a week in Spain giving some talks and got back on Thursday through JFK. And I'm always, like I said, really afraid of immigration officers. And I was there with hundreds of people waiting to cross over to have my passport inspected. And finally, it was my turn. And it just so happened that I got this interesting immigration officer, asked me, you know, where I was, what I was doing, what I'd purchased. And then he said, do you have any connecting flights? And I said, yes, I'm going on to Michigan. And he goes, why Michigan? And and I said, well, I have a job there. And he goes, oh, okay, because I see that you're boarding Cuba. And so I thought you might be going to Miami. And I said, well, I have a lot of family there. I do go to Miami a lot, but I have a job in Michigan. And I was getting really scared, you know. It's this thing of, I was an immigrant child to the United States, and I always have this fear I'm going to be deported or that I did something wrong that I don't know about. And then he looks at me and he goes, I'm Cuban too. And I just wanted to cry. And he said, where are you from in Cuba? I said, Havana. He goes, well, I'm from Matanzas. And I didn't get to tell him that a lot of my family is from Matanzas. And he just said, welcome home. And I was just such a return to the U.S. And I'm not so scared of immigration officers now. So starting there. So going on from there, I want to tell you this story. It's a family story. It's a personal story. It's a story also about my work as an anthropologist. All gets merged together. So I always like to start by telling you about my maternal grandmother, whose name was Esther. And she was an immigrant to Cuba in the 1920s, like many others, a Jewish woman from Poland. Got to Cuba in the 1920s, and there were so many Jews from Poland in Cuba that the term today still used to describe a Jewish person in Cuba is Polaco. So they assume everybody is from Poland. So here she is, recently arrived, and she was the eldest of seven children, and I have a fact checker in the audience. My cousin Norma is here, and her mom was the sister of my grandmother Esther. And my grandmother arrives first of the children because my great-grandfather had already gotten to Cuba in 1924. She arrived in 1927. And just like immigrants today, he had made just enough money to bring one of the children over. And he had sons, but she was the eldest, and she begged him to let her be the first to go to Cuba to help him bring the rest of the family to safety in Cuba, and he agreed. And so she was the first of the children to arrive. And you're probably wondering, why Cuba? Why did Jews choose the destination of Cuba at this time? And it was because of the Immigration and Nationality Act that was establishing a quota on the number of Jewish immigrants that could come to the United States. And in a time before internet, before you had maps that you could look at easily, people weren't sure exactly where they were going, but they read in the Yiddish press, my grandmother and others like her read in the Yiddish press, that if they could just get to Cuba, it was so close to the United States that they could practically swim over. And that's what they read in the Yiddish press, and so off to Cuba with the plan of eventually coming to the United States, which was the America they really wanted to go to, not the other America south of the border, but this America. This is where they wanted to come. And so they called Cuba Hotel Cuba, thinking they'd be there temporarily and then find their way to the U.S. And many did, but many others, like my family, found a home in Cuba. So here's my grandfather. And kind of like with Ellis Island, when he arrived in Cuba, his name was Moshe Aaron Glinyansky, and he became Maximo Glinsky in a short amount of time. And he was always very proud. He would show me, this was his railway ID card. He had worked on the railroad in Cuba when he arrived, as all these immigrants did, as a penniless immigrant to Cuba in 1924. So he and my grandmother meet. By this time, my grandfather has a little store in the town of Artemisa, just north of Havana, and my grandmother ends up there as an employee at his store. And he would tell this terrible joke that always upset my grandmother, which was, it was cheaper to marry her than to continue to have her as an employee. She did not like that joke, but he would often tell it. And he seduced her because he would get these Yiddish newspapers, the Forward and other Yiddish newspapers sent from New York to Cuba, and he would share those with her. So that was how they met, and she had big dreams of being a cabaret singer, but that didn't come to be because she realized she had to help her father get the rest of the family to safety in Cuba. And so I love showing this because here's their wedding invitation in Spanish and Yiddish, 1929, and you see how already this kind of Cuban Jewish culture was taking form on the island. And most of the men who arrived in Cuba, as I said, were penniless, they were street peddlers, and they fanned out all over the island of Cuba selling buttons and cloth and blankets, whatever they could, and they became famous for this. Everybody, older people in Cuba still remember these Jewish peddlers that fanned out all over the island, selling things with a little bit of Spanish that they had learned. And so here, 1934, is my mother's family, my grandmother and family, reunited, and they end up in this small town called Agramonte, in the province of Matanzas, where my immigration officer is also from. And you can see it's a rural town. You can see that there's a dirt floor, and they've put up this kind of curtain, make it look a little fancier, and they're all in, you know, their best clothes. And the family is more or less reunited. My grandparents there on the left, my great-grandmother in the center, great-grandfather on the right. And I always like pointing out that by this point, my great-grandfather, I think, looks amazingly Cuban. He just doesn't look like a Polish Jew anymore. You know, he's got the straw hat, and he's got that very Cuban, as you'll see in a moment, Jose Marti kind of mustache. And up there, just above my grandmother, is my aunt Irene, who is my cousin Norma's mother, and she's here today, my cousin. So the family's more or less reunited in this small town by 1934, right on the eve of the Holocaust. So they really get there just in time to Cuba. But I was always aware, I would see these pictures at my grandparents' house, that those relatives that decided to stay behind in Poland and Europe didn't make it, and they perished in the Holocaust. And some of them didn't want to move to Cuba because they thought Cuba was a primitive country, it was a jungle, they didn't want to go there. And this was my grandmother's grandmother who stayed behind in Poland and was killed in the Holocaust. And I would see these pictures and ask, well, who was this person? And I would hear that story, and this is my grandfather's mother who was killed in her bed, was the story we always heard by the Nazis. So I became very aware from a young age that Cuba was this refuge for my Jewish family, and that in many ways, I'm Jewish because I'm Cuban. Cuba was this refuge for the family. And so here are my grandparents by this time, late 1930s, early 1940s. They're the last ones left in the little town of Agramonte. The rest of the family has gone on to the town of Matanzas and to Havana, and they're still there in Agramonte, the only Jewish family in this town. And that's my Aunt Sylvia. My mother's the smaller girl. My uncle hadn't been born yet. And so the girls are growing up, but they're concerned what's going to happen when they're older, you know, what kind of Jewish education are they going to have in this, you know, small town. But they couldn't leave because they didn't have the means to move to Havana and open up a bigger store in the big city. But what happens? My grandfather, whom you see here, this is Maximo, he wins the Cuban lottery. He won 5,000 pesos in the Cuban lottery in the early 40s, and that was real money at the time, and it was enough for them to be able to move from the small town of Matanzas to Havana. They open up a lace store on Calle Aguacate, Avocado Street, a tiny lace store, and just big enough for the two of them and one employee and a couple of customers now and then. And though I did have an argument with my uncle, who you'll see in a minute, because he didn't like the fact that I described the store as tiny. And he said, it's not tiny, it was very small. but he felt that tiny was an offensive word. So my apology continues to hold for him. I'm so sorry. I called it tiny rather than very small. And here's the family by the 1950s, my grandparents, my mother, my aunt, and there's my uncle who was offended by the word tiny. And by then you get a sense just from this picture of the prosperity that you feel already in this family. So this is the 1950s. By then there are about 15,000 Jews in Cuba, most of them in Havana, but many others living in provincial cities. And by this time there are Jewish schools, there's Jewish radio, there's theater, there's newspapers. There's this very, very lively community. And by the end of the 1950s, they have five functioning synagogues in Havana and several synagogues in the provinces as well. So they're an amazing community because in a short amount of time, they really build a very strong culture in Cuba. So what happens? Here's my mother, very young, age of 15, she meets my father. And this is a big problem. Why? Because my father is Sephardic. Huge problem for a woman from an Ashkenazi background. They used to say at the time, better to marry a goy than a Turk. And so, and my father, born in Cuba, just like my mother, but his family is from Turkey, and this was an incredible issue, an incredible drama in my mother's family. My grandmother, who you saw at the very beginning of the show, my grandmother was, how are we going to talk to Albertico's family? They don't speak Yiddish, because Sephardic Jews do not speak Yiddish. They speak Ladino and Old Spanish, and it just seemed like a huge problem. But here's my Turkish grandparents, recently arrived in Cuba, and beautiful. Yeah, those two-tone shoes are gorgeous. And here are my grandparents again with my aunt and uncle, and that little boy in that little sort of sailor suit is my father, and then there was one more child born later. So these are the Turks, and they were very, very scared that my mother would marry a Turk, and but she did. And it was considered an intermarriage at the time, an Ashkenazi Sephardic wedding, and both sides coming together here. And my parents, like many, many other people at the time, 1956, were expecting a wonderful, marvelous future in Cuba. I'm sure many of you have pictures like this. These are just gorgeous, iconic pictures from the 50s. And so they were part of this Jewish community, again, kind of bringing together the Jewish and the Cuban in these fascinating ways. They were celebrating the centenary of José Martí, the great independence leader of Cuba. And that's the picture where I think my grandfather looks a lot like my great-grandfather looks a lot like José Martí. But it's so fascinating. They're you know, celebrating the centenary of José Martí, but in Yiddish. I thought that was so interesting, this kind of convergence of cultures that was taking place at the time. And the most important nightclub of the era as well, the Tropicana nightclub, being advertised in Spanish and Yiddish. So you really get this sense of how these cultures were at a crossroads in Cuba in the 1950s. And so I was a part of this, but I was very, very small. I was a small child at the time. Here I am on the Malecón with my mother. And standing in front of the Jewish Community Center that's also on the advertising for this program, the synagogue that we call the Patronato, just literally finished on the eve of the revolution, and we lived half a block away, so we would always pass by, and there are all these pictures of me standing in front of the synagogue. So what happens? The Jews, like everybody else in Cuba, really support the Cuban Revolution, 1959. They support Fidel Castro. Everybody wants a change. There's corruption. All these things are going wrong in Cuba, and people want, you know, this new system to come into place. So there's huge support for the revolution at the beginning. My parents are very young when the revolution starts in 59. They're a young couple with two young children, me and my brother, and they're extremely happy because one of the first reforms that Fidel Castro enacts is to reduce the rents by half. So they're delighted. Oh, we only have to pay half the amount of rent we've been paying. And the story I always heard is that with that extra money, my mother went out and bought that lamp that you see there. So that was her revolutionary lamp. And actually, those chickens ended up coming with us to the United States. I'm not sure why, but they were very important to my mother. She still has them in New York. So, you know, so it was the beginning of the revolution. They were very supportive, just the way so many other people were, the way the Jewish community was. But then a disenchantment starts occurring by the early 60s, by 1961, after the Bay of Pigs invasion, after property is nationalized, and Cuba starts moving towards a communist system. So most of the Jewish community leaves, this community of 15,000. Most of it just comes right over to the United States. About 2,000 stay, but most leave at this time. And this is my grandmother up there carrying that box. And so most leave at that time. Many go to New York and stay there, like my family did. Others go to New York and then down to Miami because they're missing the tropical weather. But the majority of the community leaves at this time. So it's a community that undergoes a double diaspora. They've gone from Europe to Cuba in the 1910s and 1920s, and by the 60s, they're moving on to the United States. And oddly enough, that America, that didn't want them in the 20s, now accepts them in the 1960s. And so it was a time, I was only a child, it was a time when it was very dramatic to leave Cuba, and you could get hassled and harassed and persecuted for wanting to leave. As you probably all know, those of us that left in that era were tagged the worms of the revolution, the gusanos. We were called for wanting to leave Cuba. Wanting to leave Cuba was a sign of lack of support for the country and for the revolution. And so those who left were limited to one suitcase. You could only take one suitcase, and properties had to be left behind, belongings had to be left behind, and what most people took were their photographs. And so I've been showing you the photographs that made it out of Cuba in that era. And before I started going back to Cuba, because I left as a child and I remember so little, it was those photographs, those old black and white photographs, that allowed me to see Cuba again in my imagination before I saw it in reality. So we went from Havana to New York. Here we are recently arrived, my parents and me and my brother, and tried to maintain this culture that was seamlessly maintained on the island, but suddenly we're in New York and there's more to take in. And of course, one of the ways in which we all maintain our culture is through food. And so I've held on to all the recipes that I've been able to get a hold of. This is my mother's recipe for black beans, frijoles negros. And then this is my grandmother's recipe for gefilte fish, but in Spanish, which is what I love. So it's her recipe for gefilte fish in Spanish, but the fish, if you can see up there, whitefish and carp and so on, those are written out in English because you have to be able to go to the fish market and ask for them in English, but the rest of the recipe in Spanish. So this is how I grew up, eating black beans and gefilte fish, and also some Turkish dishes that my paternal grandmother made. My mother in one of many kitchens and various rental apartments where we lived in New York, because we never quite settled down until I was in graduate school. That's when my parents finally bought a house in New York, because there was always this uncertainty as to whether we were staying or not. And I really wanted to learn to play the piano. And my mother said, no, you have to choose a more portable instrument, because we don't know, we might be refugees again. And so I wasn't allowed to play the piano, and they also said they didn't have room for it. And so I was given the choice of the guitar or the accordion. And I foolishly chose the guitar. I think now the accordion would have been a lot more interesting, but at the time it was the guitar, and that's what I played. And so I want to share this story with you about growing up with this double heritage, this Ashkenazi heritage, Ashkenazi and Sephardic heritage. So I grew up with my mother's Ashkenazi family, hearing Yiddish, eating gefilte fish, and yet always I was reminded by my mother's family how much I resembled my father's Sephardi family. I was told that my temperament, a strong will, a fierce rage that came from a source I couldn't begin to fathom, and an inability to forgive those who'd wronged me, was a Sephardi temperament. The stories I heard about my Sephardi family were told by my Ashkenazi family and filtered through a lens that was exoticizing. The story most often told to illustrate how strange were those Turks, those Turcos, was the tale of my brother's name. When Maury was born in 1959, my mother decided to name him Morris in memory of her father's brother Mordecai, who was killed by the Nazis. Abuelo and abuela, my Turkish grandparents, arrived at the hospital and were enraged to learn that my mother had already named the boy. Este niño es nuestro, nos pertenece a nosotros, they exclaimed. We let you name your first child, namely me, to honor your side of the family. This second child belongs to us, and we want you to name him Isaac, or Isaac in Spanish. Isaac, name him Isaac, but you're alive. We can't name him Isaac, my mother responded, and Abuelo replied, yes, I'm alive, and I want the boy named after me. Mommy, holding to the Ashkenazi custom that names are given to newborn children to honor the dead rather than give joy to the living, refused to change her mind. Abuelo and abuela announced they wouldn't attend the bris. As the day drew near and the tensions mounted between my mother and father, Baba and Zeta asked their neighbor, Rabbi Gambach, a Sephardi rabbi from Turkey, to talk sense into abuelo and abuela. He managed to persuade them that Isaac would be my brother's middle name and el abuelo Isaac would be honored just the same. They attended the bris, and a semblance of family peace and unity was restored. Why is it then that in telling this story, I want to claim the grief and loss of my Sephardi grandparents? We've never once called my brother Isaac. We never once gave abuelo that joy in life, and we still deny it to him in death. Isaac is gone from us as bitterly as the lover who sings farewell in the old Sephardi ballad. And here, I'm thinking of that song, Adio Querida. I don't know if anybody else knows it here. Adio, adio querida, no quiero la vida, me la marcaste tú. Goodbye, dear love, I don't want my love, my life anymore, you've embittered it. Very Sephardic. So growing up in New York came as a child, I didn't know English, and I had this fascinating experience of learning English with a boy named Shataro, whom you see here, he's wearing that birthday, the birthday hat. So my mother tongue is Spanish. This is the language I spoke as a little girl in Cuba. I'm told I spoke that little girl's Spanish with a lot of spunk. They tell me I was a nonstop talker, una cotorrita. But after we arrived in the U.S., I grew shy, silent. Just before I turned 6, I was dropped into a first grade classroom in Queens. I was expected to survive without being able to utter a word of English. This was in 62, before bilingual programs were introduced, and you were just supposed to learn English by osmosis. And then if you failed to learn English, you joined the dumb class. And kids knew whether they were in the dumb class or not. I knew. And Shataro from Japan was also in that class because he spoke a language that wasn't English. And I think we learned English to be able to communicate with each other. I was also very protective of him because he was a head shorter than me. And we did well, we got good at English, and at the end of the year, we were promoted out of the dumb class into a regular third grade class. But Shataro didn't continue because his family went back to Japan, and that was when I realized that we were not going back to Cuba. And we also realized he gave me a lovely gift, this lovely wooden male and female doll, both in matching kimonos, which I still have. And we realized that we weren't dumb, that what we were was dispossessed, dislocated. So moving on now to Cuba and to anthropology. So somebody with a background like me, I mean, what kind of career are you going to have with such a mix of backgrounds, of cultures, of languages, of stories? I was led to anthropology because I wanted to write and I wanted to travel. And anthropology became this incredible home for me and for all of my intellectual interests. And so I'm both. I've now become a professional traveler and I'm also an immigrant and always thinking about that double relationship. And I call myself an anthropologist who specializes in homesickness. I carry too much. My latest book is called Traveling Heavy because I travel heavy. So first trip as an anthropologist was to a small village in northern Spain, and it was an amazing, amazing, amazing time for me. I was really young, in my early 20s, living in this village. Growing up in New York, I didn't know anything about rural life and really learned about the land and where all our food comes from. Here I am back at that time. And then I had the good fortune to go on and work in Mexico and worked with this incredible woman, listened to her life story over many, many years. She had suffered from a cycle of violence in her family, domestic violence over many generations, and she was finally able to break it at great personal cost, because after she left her husband, he became blind, and people said she was a witch. And so she was ostracized in the town, but then I came along, the anthropologist appeared, very interested to hear her story, and was able to really understand one Mexican woman's life very, very closely. And I want to honor her as well, because she just passed away last week, and I was very fortunate to be able to go back to Mexico this summer and see her. So now, after those journeys, the journey to Cuba, the journey to Spain, the journey to Mexico, it was finally time, I thought, in the 90s, to go back to Cuba and research my own home, my own homeland. So what happens? The first few visits to Cuba, very, very emotional, even though I had left as such a young child. Didn't remember very much, but I just tried to stand in the places where I had stood as a child. So here I am just standing and occupying those places again, these spaces of memory, and going back to all the places I heard about, Calle Aguacate, where my mother lived, Avocado Street, where my father lived by the port, and then going back over and over to this very, very, very gracious current occupants of the apartment where we live, the one that I talked about that was reduced by half, and going to that apartment and finding out that all the furniture that my parents left behind, their bed, their vanity, their dresser, even the bedspread, were all still in that apartment and being taken care of by the occupants who are there now 50 years later. So it was just an incredibly heart-wrenching experience going back, super emotional. I reconnected with the woman who was my nanny, who fortunately is still alive in Cuba, 88 years old, this woman, Caro, and she's holding up a picture here of my cousin, Alma. And it was the most amazing thing. This is my great-grandparent. She had saved all the pictures of my family, and they're in the same box with the pictures of her family, of her kids. And I heard all these stories about my family and stories about me as a child. And I'll just summarize this one, La Cortada. My mother always used to say that Cuba was so safe that she could put me in a taxi when I was 3 years old. She'd send me from one neighborhood in La Habana to another, from El Vedado to Miramar, where my aunt and uncle live, great aunt and great uncle. And so I would go off in this taxi and, you know, and go see my aunt. But Caro had a different story to tell me. And so she tells me one day that she ran into this taxi driver, and I had no idea what she was talking about. And then she says, I wouldn't tell him. And what is it that you wouldn't tell him after so many years? Because I didn't remember the story at all. And she said that when I was a little girl, that cab driver would pinch my thighs. And I didn't like that. He pinched them all the way to my Aunt Soyla's house and back. And that's why I wouldn't get into his car again, no matter what my mother or anyone said. And Caro remembered the story, and that's when I realized that when I left Cuba, I entered this other world. I was stripped of memory, cortada, cut to the quick. And as I said, I have many fears, and I'm afraid to get too lost in Havana. Many fears. None is more terrible than my fear of getting too lost in the city of my birth and never being heard from again. And here is Caro and me, and up until very recently, she's now 88 and much more frail, she would always go with me to the airport when I left Cuba to say that last goodbye, just as she did when I was a little girl of four leaving Cuba. So we would reenact this departure over and over and over throughout the 1990s. So I wasn't the only one on a journey to Cuba, on a quest to understand Cuba in this period. The 1990s is this moment when the U.S. starts opening up again to Cuba, and Cuba starts opening up again as well to Americans. And today, as you all know, is the anniversary of the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. And it's after the fall of the Berlin Wall and after the fall of the former Soviet Union that Cuba no longer has the support that it had had during the Cold War period. Suddenly Cuba is they're on their own, and they have to find a way to survive in the global market. So Cuba starts opening up to the US and to the capitalist world, and in turn, the rest of the world starts going to Cuba. And the National Geographic runs this early story in the early 1990s, and anthropologists always say that when a country is written up in the National Geographic, it becomes safe for Americans to go there. So it was soon after the publication of this article, Evolution and the Revolution, that many Americans began to travel to Cuba. It was now possible to go throughout the 60s and 70s and 80s. It was almost impossible, in part because of the embargo and in part because Cuba also had its door closed. So it becomes possible to go, and suddenly the Buena Vista Social Club, I'm sure you've all heard this music. We start hearing Cuban music here in the US. And it becomes a kind of craze, even in Ann Arbor, where I live, and I'm part of this article here about Ann Arbor's Cuba craze. We start going through this Cuba boom, this tremendous interest in Cuba, a country that had been forbidden and taboo for so long. And also the Jews of Cuba become suddenly a subject of great interest, a community of great interest, particularly to American Jews, and this is one of many trips to Cuba that are now possible through the Jewish Museum. And there's tremendous curiosity about Fidel Castro and his relationship to the Jews, because the Jews have not experienced any discrimination as they did in Russia. The kosher butcher store remains active in Havana, and if you're registered as a member of the Jewish community, you can get kosher beef at the kosher butcher store in Havana. So Jews have kind of, you know, lived well in Cuba since the revolution. So there's been this tremendous curiosity. What's going on here? Is Fidel Castro perhaps of Sephardic ancestry? When I mentioned that, my father was a little, I kind of hope not. But anyway, there's this tremendous interest and curiosity in Cuba because of these issues. And so the Jews of Cuba, now a community of about 1,000 to 1,500 on the island, mainly in Havana, but also throughout the island, are now receiving a tremendous amount of aid from American Jews. And often it's very, very poignant, as it says in the article, we could have been them and they could have been us, and that's certainly very much how I feel, because I could have been a part of the community on the island. So after that long period of kind of my spiritual quest to reconnect with Cuba, I began to work more as an anthropologist and to study the Jewish community on the island, and I connected with an amazing photographer, Humberto Mayol, who made these pictures, plus the picture we're using on the publicity, and we began to try to document the people who are still part of this community on the island. Adela Dworin, who you see here, is the president of the Jewish community of Cuba for many years. She was the librarian, and then she was the vice president. Now she's the president. And it's a great photo also, because you see how the Jewish star is serving as a kind of bookcase, a kind of niche there in the wall. And then we have Jose Marti, once again, the independence leader. So we were seeking these convergences between the Cuban and the Jewish and the revolutionary, and trying to see if we could bring that all together into the photograph. So here's the wonderful photograph that he took. And this also brings together the American, because of course this is a 57 Chevy, and as you all know, these cars are still actively used in Cuba. So the synagogue that has all these kind of personal repercussions for me has now become a kind of pilgrimage site for all Jewish travelers who go to the island. As you see here, Adela showing people around. And the cemetery where members of my family are buried is also now a site that visitors go and visit. And I think that this community is intensely fascinating. As you can see from this picture, it seems like Che Guevara is in the synagogue as well. He's got their backs, right? So, and so going to Cuba has become this touristic, anthropological, Jewish solidarity mission, and so many people want to come back with a piece of this story because it is intensely fascinating, and I'm part of this process as well, having written a book about this community as well. So just this desire to see these Jews who still breathe the air, the revolutionary air of Che Guevara. So my project, I was trying to understand how people conceive themselves as Jews in Cuba today, And most of the community are converts. There's only about 10 to 12 Jews who are Jewish both on their mother's and father's side. Most are Jewish just on their father's side. And the Joint Distribution Committee in New York sends aid so that people can go through the conversion process, they can marry, have circumcisions, and so on, and become halachic Jews, Jews really according to the law. And so I went around talking to everybody who wanted to talk to me, who claimed a Jewish identity, and people always brought out things to show me, Jewish objects or documents or papers. And so these two boys are holding up their conversion documents because they're Jewish on their father's side, and they went through the process. They were circumcised and went through the process of converting. So they're holding up their conversion documents and saying, this is what makes us Jewish. And it's, and in fact, they have since moved to Israel, and they're now in their 20s and, you know, and living in Israel. This man, Albertico, who's very, very active, reading Torah, chanting Torah, and so on, he's holding up the tallit and the kippah that belonged to his Turkish grandfather that he still holds on to. And you can see all the memorabilia that he brought out to show me. This woman, Ida, is showing the passport that belonged to her mother and her older sister. They went to Cuba after the war, and they used their Polish passport. She was born subsequently in Cuba. And her father is a survivor of Auschwitz, and he actually brought the prison uniform with him to Cuba, and that's what she's holding up very close to her heart there. And Sara here, she's holding up the ketubah. The ketubah is the marriage contract, and she's holding that up. And it's kind of a sad picture if you know the story, because this ketubah has become a kind of passport for many younger members of the family. Her son and daughter, her niece and nephew have been able to leave Cuba for Israel using the ketubah as proof of their Jewishness. So the ketubah becomes this kind of passport now. And she's holding up here two very also moving pictures. The picture on the left is all these young women were celebrating their 15th birthday in 1959. So those were all quinceañeras, and she was among them. And then that's her picture. And she said, of all those women, I'm the only one still in Cuba. So it's also this image of kind of feeling very shipwrecked. One of my most amazing experiences was meeting Jaime Gansgreen, who you see here. He lives in a small town on the eastern end of the island near Santiago de Cuba. He's the only Jewish person in this small town. And nobody had ever asked him, do you have any Jewish memorabilia, any things that you might want to show? Opened up a drawer, and he had all of these incredible things. He pulled out this letter in Yiddish, pulled out this photograph from relatives who perished in the Holocaust, and then this incredible postcard that was sent from a concentration camp with the Hitler stamps on it. So it was just so incredibly wrenching, this meeting with him and this man in this very forgotten place who had all of this Jewish memory that he was holding on to. And others as well that I spoke to, I also spoke to very secular members of the community, very revolutionary, not involved with synagogue life. Among them, this fascinating man, Ernesto. His father called him Ernesto after Ernesto Che Guevara, very revolutionary Jewish family. And he is the dean of the physics department at the University of Havana. And his big dream is to one day have a big statue of Einstein. So that's how he claims his Jewishness, through physics. You know, so everybody's got a way. And it's very interesting, so the Cuban government is definitely aware of this Jewish American interest, you know, in the island and the Jewish community, and they built a Jewish-themed hotel in Old Havana. Some of you who've been to Cuba may be familiar with it. It's called Hotel Raquel. And so it's extremely interesting. It's a small boutique hotel with 25 rooms, and each room is named after a biblical figure. And so I stayed in the hotel. I was there with a group just when it opened in 2003, and it was very eerie because all the names were names of people in my family. My grandmother Esther, my mother Rebecca, all these names are names in my own Jewish family. And of course, there is a room named Ruth. And they reserved that room for me. And I began to wonder, is that all that's left for people like myself? Just a hotel room with my name on it. There here's the Ruth room. So I know the Ruth room will always be there. If I can afford it, it'll be there. So to end, I want to end with another poem. I also, you know, continue to go to Cuba actively. I'm going to be actually going in a couple of days with the Yiddish Book Center on a group trip to Cuba. And I'm very involved with a group of people on the island who make gorgeous handmade books in very, very small editions. And so I wrote this poem called Broken Streets of My City in English and Spanish. There's the Spanish cover. And it's a long, long narrative poem. And the streets are frequently broken in Havana. They're being fixed for various reasons, but you have to be very careful where you step. And these are some of the streets. And the cemetery also, a lot of the tombstones, if any of you have been to Cuba, a lot of the tombstones are also in disrepair. So many things are broken. And as many of you know, of course, we bring stones to those who have passed on. We don't bring flowers, we bring stones. So this sense that things are broken, but that it's also our responsibility to fix things that are broken. So all of that enters into this poem that I write about the broken streets of my city. And this is a black and white picture that the artist Rolando Esteves hand-painted, a picture from that period in the 50s. And it's in the book. And so the book kind of rolls out, like an accordion, actually, rolls out. And you can read this poem in English and Spanish. And what happened to me is I fell in Havana. I fell on one of these broken streets. And fortunately, I didn't break my elbow, but I almost did. And so I write about falling and falling in the city of my birth, and about wanting to have my parents go back to Cuba with me one day because they've never gone back. And so I come back an old child. Now they call me Señora. I still come back after so many years, an old little girl, una niña vieja. Mommy, papi, please come back. Walk these broken streets of Arabana together with me. Listen to me, your niña vieja. Let me lead you through these broken streets. Haven't been able to convince them yet to go with me. This image will help us end. It's a beautiful image by a Cuban artist named Sandra Ramos. And in the 90s, when so many people were leaving Cuba, the rafters and so on, she made this piece because she was constantly waving goodbye to everybody who was leaving. And it says, y cuando todos se han ido, llega la soledad. When everybody has left, what remains is solitude. And I just thought it was such a poignant image because my story is so much about departure, but it's also about the desire to return. And finally, it's about the desire to continue telling stories and to have the stories, in a sense, be our home. And I think that's very appropriate for this wonderful Humanities Festival. So I'll just read you this closing text. That's all I have, fragments that I trip over, like the broken sidewalks of my Havana. It's not much to go on, but I sit down at my oak desk in Michigan and turn on the computer. I thank the spirits and my ancestors for my safe journey. Next, I rub the beads on my evil eye bracelet to ask for good luck, just in case you hadn't noticed them. They are here. And I start to write. I erase most of it. I write more, erase, write again, and erase. It goes on like this for a long time until eventually some words remain on the page that I can live with. I know that if I hang in there long enough, I may be blessed. The pieces will form a story, and once a story is told, it can never be lost. Thank you.
We now have, we'll take some time for questions. If you guys can keep your hands up while we come around, we will get to you in a fast and efficient way possible.
Thank you for that. We were in Cuba in April and visited the three synagogues that are left in Havana. We went Friday night to a service, and the young man who led the service the following Tuesday left with his family for Israel. And in speaking with people, we got the impression that come 10 years from now, there will not be a Jewish community in Cuba And I'm wondering what your take is on that.
Yeah, that's a really good question. And something I write about in my book, that sometimes when I was doing my project, my research, I felt that I was talking to ghosts because I was talking to them in Cuba, and then I would find out, just like you, a day later, a week later, a month later, they were leaving the island. So I thought they were on the island, but they were about to leave. And so that's a very, very common experience. But I do believe that a Jewish community will always be in Cuba. There are many that people that I've spoken to over the years and people that I've known over the years who are very committed to staying. Some of the pictures that you saw, some of the people here are very much the ones that want to stay, could leave like anybody else who's a Jew in Cuba. Very easy to make aliyah. Israel has opened its doors to any that want to leave. But there are many who have chosen to stay, who've had that possibility and want to stay. And so I very much believe that Adela and Albertico and many of the other people that you saw pictured here are very, very committed to staying. What's also very interesting is that this community is mainly the descendants of those Jews that married out of the tribe in the 40s and 50s and were essentially ostracized for marrying out of the Jewish tribe. And so the descendants of those people are the ones that are now looking for their Jewish roots. And it's amazing. I've been going back and forth to Cuba for 23 years. And every time I go, I meet new people who've just discovered their Jewish roots, a grandparent or a great-grandparent, and they're curious and they come and they become active. And sometimes with the young people, as you saw, they learn Hebrew, they lead the service, they're incredibly committed, but then they find that they can go to Israel. And they go not because they're discriminated as Jews, they go because they know that economically they'll have a much better livelihood in Israel. And so that's what's causing those departures. But many of those people do in fact return. I've talked to many who have left and returned to celebrate a wedding or an important ritual. They come back from Israel to Cuba to celebrate those rituals. So those connections are going to stay, and I firmly believe that there are people that are very committed to staying and to maintaining that Jewish community. I don't know if you got out to Santa Clara. I didn't get to talk about that, but there's a man named David Tachet who recently, with support from the United States, just recently built a new synagogue in Santa Clara. So I think that though it seems sometimes very depressing because people are leaving, there are people who are committed to staying, and then there's constantly more children kind of coming up and growing and forming part of this community. Thank you so much. That was a great question. Thank you. Okay.
Yes, I'm Jewish. My son married a woman whose family is Cuban, and they're Catholic. But almost all the men in that family's name is Reuben. And I always wonder if they were Muranos. Do you know if there's any research on Muranos who went to Cuba from Spain?
Actually, there's a very interesting scholar, kind of an independent scholar named Jeannie Milgram, who is also Cuban, kind of the same thing, Cuban Catholic family. She began to trace her roots back to Spain, to these little towns up in northern Spain on the border with Portugal. And she discovered, she goes back like 20 grandmothers back to a small town in Spain, and they were a family of conversos because, you know, people in the 15th century had that choice. You either converted to Catholicism or you left. So the Sephardic Jews are the ones that chose to leave. And in fact, the word Sephard just means Spain in Hebrew. So the Sephardic Jews are the ones that chose departure. And then the conversos, or the marranos, which is another term that's frequently used, which in fact means pig in Spanish. So it's kind of an insulting term to sort of call the Jews by the name of the meat that they're not supposed to eat, right? So marranos became the name. So there were many marranos involved with the conquest of Cuba. And so Jeannie Milgram, if you look her up, M-I-L-G-R-O-M, you can find her story, and she just went to the archives and did all this research and found out that, sure enough, she descends from these conversos that, you know, got to Cuba long, long before. So yes, yeah, so there is that history. It hasn't been all that well researched, but I think it's a really, really fascinating topic. But I talked to many Cubans who aren't Jewish, And many of them like to say that, oh, I have a feeling that I might have a Jewish ancestor. Many of them will say that to me. You know, they've read my book, and it's like, I have a feel. I get emails from people saying, you know, I have a feeling that I'm Jewish, too. And then they'll tell me their whole story. So I think that's kind of interesting, too. And I think Cubans also kind of think of themselves as having kind of a very unique kind of story within the Caribbean as well, and their differentness makes them feel like they might have something Jewish about them as well. So do look up Jeannie, and I think that'll give you some interesting history to look into.
Hi, Rudy.
Hey.
I don't know if this works. When you took us to Cuba about 10 years ago, I was very impressed by the fact that for those who converted, they had to wait years for a moel to come and do the circumcision. It seemed very painful that kids who were 7, 10 years old were getting circumcised. And so that's my question. Has the situation improved any? Do they have people who come more often? And the other question is, I'm curious if the people who are converting are choosing to be Ashkenazi versus Sephardic, or have everything melded into one? So those are my questions.
I have to follow up on that question. This is my cousin Norma, so I'm so glad she's here. She's my fact checker. And I think they're sending people more consistently to Cuba. You know, they have to send the Beit Din, the three rabbis, to have, you know, a proper conversion ceremony. And the dedication that you see among the men, the boys and the men, and going through circumcision, I mean, 8 or 9 is rough, but consider being 69 years old and going through a circumcision. And you know, I write about that in my book. I talked to this man who said, he said, Abraham did it and he was much older. So why not me? You know, and he was just totally, you know, committed to it. So the Joint Distribution Committee does continue to send teachers from Argentina because they speak Spanish. But now the Jewish community knows so much that they really can run the services on their own. They know a lot of Hebrew, they know a lot of Jewish history, and they do send one particular rabbi who's been involved with the community since the 90s, and he goes very, very frequently and checks in on, you know, on the community. So I think there's a little bit better, you know, support now for the community. And as for the conversions, you know, I don't really know. I haven't asked that question. That's a really good question. Are they converting to being Ashkenazi or being Sephardic? The majority of Jews in Cuba are of Sephardic ancestry right now. So it may be that they do kind of automatically, you know, become Sephardic. But I think at this point, and actually this is a topic that I'm going to be writing about in the next few months, I want to know what it means to be Ashkenazi or Sephardic nowadays. How important are those categories nowadays in the modern world? So it's one of the things I'm actually wondering about, and I'll be going to Cuba on Friday, so I will ask and let you know what I find out. Thank you.
Next question is back here, and then we have one more after that.
So okay. I've got two parts to my question. One is, have you found any information about Jews?
Where are you?
Right over here.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Have you found information about Jews who emigrated from Europe in the mid-1800s, in the 19th century? And then the other question I have is, your family was in Cuba for a relatively short period of time. Do you have any curiosity, or have you done any research on their Turkish and Polish roots?
Well, there wasn't really any Jewish immigration to Cuba before the early 1900s because, you know, Cuba was still a colony of Spain until 1898. And then after 1902, it basically becomes, you know, a colony of the United States in the early 1900s. And that's when it becomes possible to publicly observe another religion apart from Catholicism. So it's not until the early 1900s that you have Jews immigrating to Cuba, and that's also when Protestants begin to figure in Cuban life as well, because that, of course, was also forbidden under, you know, under the Spanish crown and church. So answer to that question. And the other question was about learning, do I know more about the immigration of my roots? You know, I haven't examined that as much as I would like to. I have been back to the town where my grandmother was from, where the whole maternal side was from, a small town called Goworovo, near Warsaw, and I had the most amazing experience. I met a man named Mr. Grinberg, who was also from Goworovo, And I wanted to talk to him, and there was some concern as to whether we would be able to communicate because he doesn't speak English. But he speaks eight languages, just English isn't one of them, Polish and Yiddish and German and so on. But then it turned out that he had lived in Spain for a few years, so we ended up communicating in Spanish. It was the most amazing thing. And so he told me a lot about Goworowo, and I went to Poland with the Yiskor book, you know, about the Yiskor books for all the shtetls in Poland, and I had the Yiskor book because my grandmother had always, you know, really cherished it, and then I inherited it after her death. And so I went to Poland with the Yiskor book, and when I appeared at his doorstep with the book, he just nearly fainted because he had lost his, and the fact that I had the book from the town just said, oh, well, and he, you know, said that I looked just like some of my, you know, great-grand family. And so that was amazing. So I had that amazing connection with somebody from the town. So I did that, and then I've also been to the town near Istanbul where my father's family was from. So I've kind of visited the places, but I haven't done the genealogical research that, say, the Jeannie Milgram has done. But I really would like to someday. I think that would be really amazing. So thank you.
We have time for one last quick question.
Do you have a sense of what's going to happen after the Castro brothers are gone? Politically, is there another generation?
Well, here's the joke that people say in Cuba about the future. They say, you know, how, well, Raul Castro was appointed now, you know, to take over for Fidel. So the joke is that Raul is going to die before Fidel. That's a very Cuban joke. So it's hard to tell. I mean, I don't have a crystal ball, and anytime people try to predict the future of Cuba, it's something else. It's very, very hard to know what's going to happen after both Castro brothers and the near future. People sometimes joke that Fidel is eternal and he's always going to be there. So it's very, very hard to know, but you know, in 10 or 20 years, you know, we really, really don't know for sure, but it does seem like there's a very strong system in place that even though people are critical of it in many ways, it also provides a lot of security and safety for people as well. It's a place with a very low crime rate. You know, there's kind of a lot of safety in Cuba, and there's, of course, all the things that we've heard about, the medical system and the educational system. And so there's all these benefits of the revolution that people are very afraid to lose. And I think also now with, you know, the incursion of more and more capitalism into Cuba, we're seeing more and more inequality in Cuba, and it's very clear, you know, you two were there, and, you know, it's very clear now you can see, like, who some of the privileged people are and the less privileged people. There are people that still totally depend on the rationing system that provides a minimum of food for everybody. And then there's others who are so well off who are working in tourism and other, you know, new businesses on the island, and they're saying, we don't need that anymore. Let's just get rid of that rationing system. But they don't understand that now there's a whole community on the island that absolutely depends on it. So there's growing inequality. Things are changing very, very rapidly. And so it's hard to know how all of that, what kind of impact these economic changes and social changes are going to have on the political system. But at least for the time being, it seems like a very strong political system, and they have a whole kind of group of younger, you know, leaders kind of there, you know, holding up that system. So it's hard to tell, I think, at the moment whether there's ever going to be, you know, a major change to something looking more like an American democracy. Very, very hard to tell whether that's going to happen. Thank you so much.